Hi, this is Holly with Presence Point, and welcome back to our second Peter series. This week, we're moving to chapter 3 of Peter's second letter to Christ followers in the northern portion of Asia Minor, the peninsula that now forms most of Turkey. He opens this portion of his letter by reminding these believers that he cares deeply for them. In fact, the word he uses is translated beloved, and it indicates that he has a special affection for those he's writing to and a special relationship with them. Let's read the first portion of the passage we're focusing on today, 2 Peter 3, verses 1 and 2. This is now the second letter that I'm writing to you, beloved. In both of them, I'm stirring up your sincere mind by way of reminder that you should remember the predictions of the holy prophets and the commandment of the Lord and Savior through your apostles. You know, it's interesting that Peter has not called these brothers and sisters in Christ beloved in this letter until now. But in this last chapter, in just 18 verses, he references them in this regard four times. Peter is repeatedly calling them beloved now because he's shifting here from denouncing false teachers to exhorting the body of Christ. And he wants them to know how deep his affection is for them. He's imploring them to listen because of how much he loves them. And he does not want them to miss what he's about to say toward the end of this letter. It's just too important. It reminds me of times in my life when I've looked at our children or others that I love more than words can express, and I say, "Sweetheart, please don't miss this. I want you to pay close attention because I love you so much." They are my beloved. It seems that Peter hopes the reminder of how much he cares for them will make them even more keen to pay attention to what he's about to say. He wants to assure these believers remembered what the prophets of old had said and what the apostles had taught them related to the commands that were given by the authority of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He's reminding them that what he's about to tell them is not coming just from him alone, but from the ancients who spoke with the authority of God and by the number one rabbi of all time, Jesus Christ, their master and Lord. You know, I'm not convinced Peter was frustrated with those to whom he was writing as much as he knew that even good people with good intentions can have a bad memory. After all, how many of us have read the scriptures often, maybe even every morning, but forget what we've read just 3 days later? That's why we need regular reminders. As a friend of mine says, spiritual post-it notes to help us remember what's important. We need consistent time under the teaching of God's word. Consistent personal time in God's word, and consistent time discussing God's word with like-minded folks. The people to whom Peter was writing may have been sincere believers who needed to have their memories stirred, kind of like a fire needs stoking, right, from time to time, so they would not forget. And what did Peter think was important for them to remember? Well, the next two verses tell us. 2 Peter 3, verses 3 and 4. Knowing this, first of all, that scoffers will come in the last days with scoffing, following their own sinful desires. They will say, "Where's the promise of his coming? For ever since the fathers fell asleep, all things are continuing as they were from the beginning of creation." Because Peter loved these brothers and sisters so deeply, he wanted to ensure they knew that scoffers, those who treat lightly that which ought to be taken seriously, were going to surface. You know, I can't help but remember the scoffers in the early days of Scripture, those of Noah's day who scoffed at the idea of judgment, and the citizens of Sodom who scoffed at the possibility of fire and brimstone destroying their sinful city. Then, of course, there are today's scoffers. If you have witnessed at all for Jesus Christ or shared your testimony to others who don't believe, you no doubt have met those who scoff at the idea of hell or those who scoff at the idea of a judgment day. The scoffers Peter were warning these believers about, and ultimately us about, were those who would plant seeds of doubt that Jesus was coming a second time. And how did Peter know that scoffers or ridiculers would come? Well, because the prophets of old, men of God, had predicted it, and because the Son of Man, the Messiah himself, had warned about it. And we can't forget that we know that Peter himself witnessed scoffers of our Lord, right? There have been scoffers since Jesus came the first time, and there will be scoffers or ridiculers, again, those who treat lightly that which ought to be taken seriously, until Jesus comes a second time. It's not like you and I have not experienced those who treat lightly the truths of God, the saddest being those who know better. So when would scoffers come? Well, Peter said, now, in the last days, the days between the first coming of Christ and the second coming of Christ. Another question we have to ask is why? Why do these people exist? Why do people ridicule God's word? Well, Peter makes it really pretty clear. Because these men and women follow their own sinful desires. Peter is leaving no room for us to wonder about the why people scoff or the purpose of their ridicule. It is clear that it's because they are following their own evil cravings. In fact, Peter talks about this earlier in this same letter, when in chapter 2 he says, "False teachers indulge in the lust of defiling passion, and they entice by sensual passions of the flesh." After all, if your lifestyle contradicts the word of God, you must either change your lifestyle or change the word of God. These people will scoff at the second coming of Christ, as Peter warns, but they will also scoff at living a godly life. As pastor and author Alistair Begg points out, these men and women have a vested interest in denying the return of Jesus Christ, because as long as he is not coming back, there is no judgment to face. There is no report card to fill out. There is no event that yet awaits us that will call us to account. So the self-indulgent have a definite interest in convincing themselves and then those who would listen to them that Jesus will not return. They're saying, it's not going to happen. These things have been going on for years. So yes, the scoffers do so deliberately. Let's look at the remainder of our passage for this week, 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 5 through 7. For they deliberately overlook this fact, that the heavens existed long ago, and the earth was formed out of water and through water by the word of God, and that by means of these the world that then existed was deluged with water and perished. But by the same word the heavens and earth that now exist are stored up for fire, being kept until the day of judgment and destruction of the ungodly. Scoffers choose to do what they do. It's not like they don't know the truth. They simply decide to overlook it. In digging into the original language, the Greek word that was translated deliberately in verse 5 means to decide, to want to wish, to desire. And the word translated as overlook means to keep secret, escape notice, be hidden, forget. Yes, scoffers will intentionally forget that God created the heavens by his word, that he formed the earth out of water and through water by his word, a clear reference to Genesis and the creation. And that by the same means, i.e. water and his word, that the world was once existed, was buried by water and the ancient world was destroyed. Another clear reference to Genesis and the flood. Peter reminded the reader of what God had done in the past, proving that his work is consistent through the ages. And then he states this, by the same word, the word that created and the word that destroyed, by that same word, the world as we know it, the heavens and the earth that now exist are stored up or reserved for fire, being kept until the day of judgment and destruction of the ungodly. No wonder Peter had called these believers beloved. He didn't want them to be lured by the scoffers and not prepared for judgment. He loved them too much not to warn them. As Lon Solomon, pastor emeritus of McLean Bible Church, says, so what? So what, Holly, as a shepherd leader, do I do with this? Why do I need to know this as a shepherd of others? Because, beloved, you and I have responsibility related to those we lead. First, to be in God's word so we do not forget what it says and can live accordingly, being an example to those we lead, whether that is at church, whether it's at home, at work, in ministry, or in your community. Second, we have a responsibility to recognize scoffers and act accordingly when we identify them. Those we influence and impact are the sheep of his pasture. Three, we have a responsibility to remember that God's word is true and it is consistent. We need to communicate it as such and live like we believe it. And four, we have a responsibility to remember that this present universe is disposable, and it will be destroyed. So as an under-shepherd of God's sheep, plan accordingly. We need to be sure the beloveds in our lives know that, and know why we believe what we believe, and why we do what we do. Second epistle of Peter is not to be taken lightly. It is to be read, understood, and as Peter said, remembered. Thank you for joining me. I pray you'll join me next week as we venture into verses 8 through 10 of this chapter. And I pray that you'll live deeply into your calling this week, my beloved, as the Father's under-shepherd of those he has given you the privilege of influencing, impacting, and leading for him. Bless you.